are directly involved in reading fluency and comprehension. So the concept here is that we're going to expand on that whole concept or idea that the base of dyslexia is strictly just phonological processing. So I wanted to start by just giving you an overview of what it is. And quite frankly, it's beautiful in the sense that the rapid automatized naming task is a very simple task that has very powerful impact on our ability to remediate. So the task is nothing more than measuring how quickly a person can name letters or digits or pictures or colors, the choice of which should be, of course, based on their age. But what we do know is that if we include this in our assessment of children, then we can get a very strong predictor with regard to whether the child may be struggling with reading fluency and comprehension as they develop as a skilled reader. So the research is really clear that if we measure this early and we see difficulties in this area, we can predict very strongly that we need to intervene specifically in these areas of fluency and comprehension beyond just phonological processing. Now, one of the resources that I provided for you is a seminal article by Elizabeth Norton and Marianne Wolf, and I strongly urge all of you to take a look at that. It's very readable. It's accessible to a large group of people, and I think they do a really wonderful job, you know, really sussing out all the different aspects of what it means to understand rapid automatic naming. So their quote is, "Fluent reading depends on a complex set of cognitive processes," and read that as language, oral language processes, "that must work together in perfect concert." So again, here is that introduction to the idea that we've got to build on this model of dyslexia being connected to just phonological awareness and working and developing much more complex understanding of other kinds of oral language development that is directly related to literacy development. So these RON tasks provide insight into that and act as a bit of a microcosm of the processes that are involved in reading. So here's my rationale. I've been relatively implicit. What's clear is this from the research, that clearly teaching decoding skills is necessary. It is definitely a substrate or foundational skill specifically related to phonological awareness, that if a child is struggling with sounding out words, decoding words, that implicit, explicit, systematized way of teaching is necessary, but clearly the research now tells us it's not sufficient. So what we're moving toward, and what I'm really talking about here, is we've known in the research that we need to integrate this knowledge into our practice. So we're essentially, in a way, crossing the chasm of understanding how we take what's in the reading science and integrate it into the classroom in a way that's useful and helpful to not only the children but to the teachers as well, so they're armed with what they need to be able to be effective in the classroom with these kids who struggle in this particular area. So we need a clearer understanding of the interplay of phonology, rapid automatic naming, and I'll talk about a little bit about orthographic awareness as well. So historically, in the research, there's been a massive database developed that's specifically about phonological awareness, phonemic awareness intervention. The neuroscience has identified specific neural structures and pathways. We can see the difference in the performance of those neural structures before a child gets treatment and after a child gets treatment, but we're way behind with regard to being able to integrate our understanding of these higher order language processing issues that are specific and additional to what we understand about phonology and reading. So the challenge is this, I think. When we talk about teaching a child decoding, we talk about this systematic, explicit, multisensory model of instruction whose goal is to create automaticity in sound symbol relationships, or that we want to help the student become more automatic with regard to how they efficiently decode or sound out words. Now, the challenge, I think, is for us to go beyond just automaticity and start thinking in our own minds about connectivity. So it's not just phonology. It's like, how do we understand orthography and how we integrate that into our classroom work? Morphology, syntax, and semantics. Now, I know that there's a broad group out there, and I don't want us to get caught up on some kind of arcane technology, so I just wanted to take a moment to demystify these definitions so that they make sense and we don't have to use arcane terminology that may not be something that people are familiar with. So just quickly, the orthography piece is nothing more than the practice or study of correct spelling. In other words, it's how do letters connect with sounds that are then used to form words. So the real issue here is, say, for instance, what's the most effective way to make sure that we teach a student to understand that a B is formed that way, a D is formed that way, and that those B and Ds can go together, go together with specific sounds related to those orthographic representations or those printed letters on the page. So that's a very, very simple explanation of orthography. Morphology is just nothing more than how words are structured to create or change meaning. And by that, we have root words. If we add a prefix, if we add a suffix, then we are literally changing the meaning of the word. And my favorite silly little explanation is everybody knows very quickly that husband versus ex-husband have very different meanings. So it's kind of something that's kind of easy to see, and it's illustrative of what this point is about, how we can just educate our kids to understand all those different rules of morphology, which will then help them become more effective readers and writers. Now, syntax is also nothing more than how we support a child's efforts to order words in a sentence to create meaning, order sentences in a paragraph to create meaning, order paragraphs in a connected body of text to create sense and meaning. So again, it's just all about thinking about, well, how do we actually integrate this into the classroom so that we're explicitly teaching our kids how to do this? And then finally, semantic knowledge. I think all of you would know that just means semantics equals meaning, and that would be the meaning of a word, meaning of a phrase, or a chunk of text. And really, it just reflects our interest in being explicit and going beyond just phonology and making sure that this is part of our daily work with our kids. Now, just know that by the end of this presentation this morning, I will be discussing some specific approaches or programs that we can explore with regard to being able to do that so that teachers are getting the proper support. Now, there are implications for building this kind of an expanded map. And again, I'm going to quote Marianne Wolfe. And she had this beautiful way of saying that fluency should be part and parcel of how we teach reading and how we teach teachers of reading. And again, implicitly what I've been saying, in other words, we should be as explicit in how we help a child learn to read fluently as we are in teaching a child to decode a word accurately. So I talk about it in terms of, on a process level, building a container. And there's going to be a great quote in a couple of slides here. But basically, we're talking about how do we as adults, whether we're parents, whether we're teachers, part of the school team, whether we're specialists, tutors, How do we, as the adults, organize around the child to support this concept of deep reading? And I'll explain deep reading a little bit more in a way. But it's basically, how do we find a way to make sure that if a child is struggling in this area, that we're explicitly addressing it in the classroom? Now, as I mentioned, the neuroscience has been very, very strong in identifying neural pathways, structures for phonological processing, what happens when you treat them. Just now, in the last few years, they finally have begun to publish some studies that show different neural pathways being involved, specifically for rapid automatic naming, which again, remember, is just a indicator or tip of the iceberg for these other language processing skills. So what that means is that, first of all, we got to get that reading science into the hands of the teachers so they can build out their model and build out their map. But also, it clearly indicates the need for different intervention approaches beyond phonological deficit remediation or beyond the decoding piece. Now, there's another caveat here that I wanted to just mention to you, and that is that there are some research that has said, well, look, if they have a problem with fluency, let's take a body of connected text and let's just have them repeat it and practice it, and so they can kind of increase their speed and their fluency, and, you know, problem solved. The problem with that is that if you think back to what we just talked about, if we're just focusing on their reading rate or their reading prosody or their, you know, how they intonate words, they're missing out on all the other aspects of deep reading, including the semantics and the syntax and the impact on orthography. So it's a complex process, lots of moving pieces at the same time, and if you just focus on reading rate, you're still missing out on the ultimate goal of reading, which is comprehension, of course. Now, we're not going to go deep dive into this, but I wanted to just point out that there's a couple of key tests that we should be using to assess how a child's doing with rapid automatic naming. Historically, the most popular has been the Comprehensive Test of Phonological Processing, second edition. Marianne Wolf, also in tandem with Dr. Martha Dankle at Johns Hopkins, developed another test called Rapid Automatic Naming, Rapid Alternating Stimulus. These are two tests that I would suggest that you get familiar with. We're going to talk about them at a very high level this morning, but I want to let you know that they're there, they're available, they're easy to give, and they provide very powerful information. Now, more recently, everybody wants to get in the game, so to speak, because people are recognizing how important it is. So those of you who use the Woodcock-Johnson 4th edition, obviously you'll see that there are tests for rapid automatic naming in that, and the new Wechsler Intelligence Scale for Children, the 5th edition that's come out sometime in the last couple of years, also has some sub-tests in it. But those of you who have been clinicians for several years probably will be very comfortable and familiar with these two particular tests that I mentioned. And any parents out there, I want to make sure you understand that these are eminently understandable. They're not excessively clinical, and they'll give you the language you need to be able to talk about, okay, this is where my child is performing. What specifically do we do about it in the classroom and in the tutoring that is being implemented? So very quickly, the Comprehensive Test of Phonological Awareness 2, it's called the CTOP. It has three major parts to it, and you can see the intellectual beauty of it, you know, when they're testing for overall phonological awareness. They're testing for phonological memory, which, of course, memory is a huge component that would be important for us to know about a child's profile of strengths and weaknesses. And then finally, very quick but very, very powerful rapid naming composite scores. And you can do digit naming, you can do rapid letter naming. There's some other subtests. If the child is younger, they haven't been identified, or they haven't been introduced to letters or numbers yet, then you can use colors, you can use objects, and so forth. So it's not predicated on a child having to be at a certain school age where they've been identified as, introduced to the beginning aspects of letters and numbers. So what do we remember about RON testing? It's quick, it's easy, it's powerful. The research is very, very clear. It's a powerful predictor of future difficulties with fluency and comprehension, and it must be a part of every evaluation. Now, also, the piece that is important here is that this is not something that we should be doing sequentially, okay? We need to understand if that's where the child's profile is. We don't go through the process of automaticity with decoding without also creating time in the day for us to be able to focus on fluency and comprehension. So it must be a part and parcel of the entire program. And early intervention is a must. I didn't really clearly state this, but even at the early stages, at 3 or 4 years of age, we can test the child's rapid automatic naming with colors, at least, if not objects, and use that as a predictor for when the child is introduced to letters and numbers, whether we need to keep a very close eye to make sure that we're catching it very early, and if intervention is necessary, then we're ready to do that. So early intervention is a must, but we have to keep in mind that the rapid automatic naming piece is just an indicator. It's just a red flag. It's not what we should be focusing on. What we need to be focusing on is the higher order language processing skills. Now, here's a visual representation of this idea of supporting automaticity and connectivity together. And again, you kind of tell by now, I'm a big fan of Marianne Wolf. And she had this beautiful sentence in that the goal is to simulate in our teaching what the brain does when it reads a single word, a paragraph, or a text. So I'm going to drill down into this a couple of slides from now, but the idea is that we're going to think about a child's age, their grade. We're going to think about the core words that are important for them to understand at a deep meaning or a deep reading level, and then we're going to instruct explicitly and systematically not just phonology, but morphology, semantics, syntax, and orthography, so that we're creating more connections towards or with these core words so that we can provide the children with a deeper impact in terms of their understanding and then hence hopefully their retrieval. So this is another fascinating but also difficult issue, and that is that, as you, I'm sure all of you know, that there are many programs, there are many approaches with regard to phonological awareness and phonemic processing and intervention, right? Of course, everyone's aware of Orton-Gillingham and a number of other approaches that directly address that, and they provide these structured programs or approaches that can be used in the classroom or in tutoring. Unfortunately, because we haven't crossed the chasm again between what's in the science of reading and what we're providing our teachers in their training and their professional development, there is a very significant lag in terms of organized, explicit, programs that particularly focus on fluency and comprehension. But I do want to introduce you to two, and there is more information about these in links that I provided you in the resources of this presentation, where you can drill down much more deeply into what are these programs and how might we be able to implement what's going on in our classroom. So there are two, which is, amazing considering what we have in phonological awareness. One is Connect to Comprehension by this colleague of mine whose name is Lynn Givens. We're going to talk about that a little bit in more detail, and also Marianne Wolfe's own program called RAVO, just to be clear, I don't have any personal benefit from introducing either one of these programs to you, so I'm not in any kind of a marketing mode. This is just two programs that I know that are very effective and provide the kind of support I think teachers really need in order to be able to be effective with this whole concept of connecting the broader base of oral language with the oral language set of skills with literacy development. And that's really the core of what we want to get to. So, Connect Comprehension, developed by Lynn Givens. Lynn has been practicing in the field for over 35 years. She's at Florida State University, which is one of the top universities in the United States for reading science. She's been out in the field for decades, and she found that there was a real dearth of instruction support for teachers beyond anything that had to do with just phonological awareness. So she kind of created a program. No, not kind of. She did create a program that centered around the five components of reading: the phonemic awareness, phonics, fluency, vocabulary, and comprehension. Now, that's the content level. The process level, which is very, very important, is that she created this program so that teachers have an extremely high level of support. Because, you know, what do you hear from teachers? Look, I'm already overloaded. I'm already required to do this. I'm required to do that. How am I going to be able to do this? And how am I going to be able to do it with any kind of fidelity? So I'm really kind of implying that there has to be leadership-level decision-making that supports teachers in their efforts to get the proper training and the proper professional development, because this is clearly what the research shows works. So there has to be a very strong level of support for teachers. So in this particular program or approach, there are very scripted manuals where the teacher can know exactly what they need to do every single day in the classroom. Everything is completely mapped out. That's a great anchor for particularly younger students, but it's also a great anchor for older, more experienced teachers who can kind of, they're more masterful in terms of being able to take that information and make it their own and find ways to import that information to the kids. So there's all kinds of content and manuals that go with this. In addition to that, which I think is really critical, is there are PowerPoints, there's audio discussions, there's video examples, there's research on it, there's online training, and I think maybe perhaps for us in India, one of the key components is that there is a Facebook community. And I know that social media has had a profound impact. I know it's had a profound impact in the United States, and I've read that it's had a profound impact in India as well, as being able to be the first place where, for no expense, we can create a community of people who are professionals in a particular area, and they can share information, they can ask questions, they can support each other, and they can provide, finally, the sense that you're not alone, and you're not out there trying to do this by yourself. And it becomes a huge opportunity to continue your learning, continue being able to support others, and it really builds that increased capacity or probability that we're going to be able to do this in a way where it becomes a source of strength for the teacher as opposed to a source of tension and a sense of being overwhelmed because it's one more thing I have to do. So I hope that makes sense. It's a really critical point that I'd like to make. Now, this is an important slide because I mentioned deep reading several times. And so I want to go through this because this is part of what Connect to Comprehension does. Not part of it, it's kind of the core. Not only are we talking about increasing decoding skills, but we're also talking about very systematically and explicitly increasing oral reading fluency through decodable text. I think most of you not all of you know what decodable text is. In English, it's one of the most difficult languages to learn how to read because there's a lot of your regular rules and regulations about how to decode. So you use text that's decodable, that follows the phonics rules. We explicitly increase engagement and motivation by using books that are interesting to the kids. We explicitly discuss upper level comprehension, vocabulary, and written expression, so that there's this baked in way of directly connecting, and I don't want to sound like a broken record, but this is critical, the oral language component of cognitive processing to our instruction so that it becomes skilled readers. Now, Marianne Wolfe's program, that's RAVO, is obviously an acronym for retrieval, automaticity, vocabulary, elaboration, and orthography. And what it does is essentially what the other program does. There's a bit of a difference. The RAVO program is norm-referenced, and it only operates through the lower, through grade 4 or 5. So I know there's been work being done to try to expand on that. Lynn Given's program actually starts where you are. So there's a lot of flexibility with regard to the kinds of support materials that you can use, so it's age appropriate or grade appropriate. But again, this is one of the best tools that we have available. It captures the multiple skills and processes that kids with a reading impairment need. In other words, remember, we're creating a container around this child where we're simulating what the brain should be doing. It provides a lot of substantial support for instructors. There's a community again. And the way this works is that with RAVO, and I'll show this to you in the slide, for each grade, for each period of the year, core words are identified where these are words that kids should really understand, and they should be capable of understanding those words in a lot of different ways. So it's not just if we're in a very early stage, we're talking about that. That's the core word. Not only will we focus on the phonics and the phonemic awareness and the pronunciation, but the spelling patterns, the multiple meanings of bats. Are we talking about the animal? Are we talking about a cricket bat? How is it used in terms of parts of speech? Let's look at what happens when we change, we put a suffix or a prefix on this word. What happens when we, how well do we understand the root of the word? So all of this is baked into your day-to-day work with a child in order to support that deep meaning, which then allows them to be much more effective in terms of their commitment to memory, and then therefore, of course, obviously, the goal is for them to be able to retrieve this information and improve their comprehension over time. So we're, again, simulating what the brain should be doing, but because of this particular neurobiological profile, that's something that we need to spend extra time on. So there's a couple of programs. I think that there's much more work that needs to be done in this area, but I didn't want to talk about rapid automatic naming today unless you talked about, you know, what it meant, but even more so, it's okay, fine, that's what it means. How do we actually do anything about it in the classroom? I mean, that's really what it's down to. There's a couple things for me. It's, you know, how do we cross the chasm between the science of reading and how we're supporting our teachers and our children? And then also, how do we really build this systematic, explicit, multi-century way of supporting our kids? So before I know we're going to do some Q&A here, so I wanted to just walk through these resources with you. I've got a couple links here for you that you can cut and paste that will give you a much deeper understanding of the Connect to Connect Comprehension Program. Also, I interviewed Lynn Givens for my website. It's a blog post, and we drilled down deeply into the history and the why and what's going on behind there, and I thought maybe that you might find that useful or helpful in order to get a better understanding of what her philosophical thinking was when she developed this. And then, as I mentioned, the Norton and Wolf article, highly, highly recommended. It's incredibly beautifully written. It's accessible. And I think that even if there's a couple of sections that are getting a little bit too deep into the neuroscience, just pass over those and just take a look at what you know, what they're saying in more general terms about the philosophy. And then again, of course, more information about the RAVO program. It's out of Tufts University, where Dr. Wolf until recently was running a reading clinic there. And I think it's state of the art as far as we've got right now. And I think it's a really solid program. It's got research to support it. So I think it's something that we really behooves us to take a look. Now, just a couple other links here. The last one is really actually what I just referenced, which is the reading research on RAVO. But for those of you who aren't aware yet, the University of Michigan in the United States has a dyslexia section in their website, which is very, very solid. There's a lot of really good information there about a lot of different aspects of how to take care of our dyslexic kids. And I just happened to add this one specific document that has to do with morphology, and I thought, you know, it might be something that you find to be useful. So that's it for today. I wanted to finish with this beautiful quote that I think really just fills my spirit. So it is with children who learn to read fluently and well. They begin to take flight into whole new worlds as effortlessly as young birds take to the sky. So I want to leave you with that quote, because I just thought it was a beautiful way to think about it and finish your evening. And I know Aditi, we're going to do some Q&A. I just want to let you know that you can take a look at my website. And if you have any specific questions, please feel free to contact me at my professional email, and I'll be happy to help you with any questions or comments that you have at any time. So Aditi, I cannot hear you, and I'm not quite sure why.
Dr. Hart?
There we go. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Thanks for a wonderful talk. I'm sure all our listeners have benefited a lot from the talk. And I've already received a couple of questions from my colleagues here.
Okay.
The first question is, how effective is technology in increasing the motivation and engagement to read?
Well, I'm very glad that that question was asked, because that's a super important question. And the answer is tremendously. That's a whole other presentation, which, quite frankly, I would love to be able to do with you. I think what technology has done on the most base level, if you think about kids who are dyslexic, who have reading problems or writing problems, there's like, they may be incredibly bright, but the roadblocks of decoding issues or fine motor issues or even working memory issues could impede their ability to perform at the level you would expect based on their intellectual capabilities. So when you start talking about assistive technology tools like speech to text, where a highly verbal child who struggles dramatically with reading can all of a sudden, with a bit of a learning curve, learn to use speech to text to develop product in their academic environment, it's an incredibly powerful tool. Conversely, there are many, many ways of doing this, but audiobooks provide the opportunity as another tool for the child to not only read a text, but also listen to the text, have each word highlighted as they are reading the text, and it provides a whole new channel for the child to be able to comprehend and develop that deeper reading oral language type of skill. So that's just two examples. I mean, there's many, many other tools out there right now that I think are just tools that are actually embedded in cell phones and the Apple phones and other phones, the Android phones. There's tools embedded in the tablets that allow kids to bypass the roadblocks that they have by virtue of their neurobiological profile. And it's going to be continue to be a massive explosion for kids who have been held back because of these very specific roadblocks that they've had. So I would love us to be able to do a webinar on that sometime soon.
Ah, we would love to host that webinar, Dr. Hart. So the next question that I have for you is, can you please provide an example of how rapid naming task is conducted?
Yes. When I put this presentation together, I knew it was going to be X number of minutes long. So I wanted to make sure that I covered what I thought I should, and I had to make a decision about what to put in, what to put out. But very simply, the task, say for instance, the task is rapid automatic naming of letters. So literally, the child is, and if you send an email to me, I can send you examples of this. The child is given a card with 5 rows of 10 digits, or 5 letters, excuse me. And the child is then asked to go across the rows and just name those letters as quickly as possible. They're timed, and based on their time, we have norm reference groups where we can say, okay, based on their age, they should have scored within this range. They may be above it, they may be below it, but it's going to give us the clinical information for us to know that this is something that we need to look into. Conversely, with colors, it's the same thing. It's a pretty similar concept in that the child is administered, given a card, and there are 5 rows of 10 items, and the child is oriented to the task, and then they're just asked to start, and then they have to name them as quickly as possible, and it's just timed. And that's the beauty and the power of it, quite frankly. But again, if someone would like to see some examples, I'd be happy. Just email me and I'll send you some specific examples of what it looks like.
So, we have another question. How effective is technology in increasing the motivation and engagement to read?
Well, I think another great question. I think it can be because it's so stimulating, right?
Yeah.
In so many ways for me, it's like we're opening up the entire world to our kids. So kids who really, really struggle with the printed word in a book that to them on a neurological level can be extraordinarily painful and boring. You know, just being able to get access to the entire universe of the internet and being able to access images, being able to access videos, being able to, in many ways, when kids are a little bit older, build their own products, their own films, their own videos, their own graphic representations of what they're working on, it provides a whole new world in terms of finding what lights up that child, what excites that child, and then being able to integrate those kinds of skills into the learning process. I know many in the United States, many, many teachers are starting to make use of tablets, iPads, whatever, that allow a child, instead of having to write a story or write a paper, they build a video and they go around and they interview people, they take video of things, they describe it, they talk about it. It just opens up this whole world of being able to learn, but it's in a more a non-traditional way, which now very quickly is going to be traditional because we aren't going to be able to stop what's happening with digital media and what's happening with the internet, and we should. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing for our kids.
That's a very interesting point that you made, Dr. Ha, that it's a beautiful thing, but I know many parents are really wary of technology. They would still prefer handing a book to a child than, handing a Kindle or an iPad or any other, like a mobile phone. So what are your views on that? Should technology replace the books and the traditional methods of teaching, or
No, I
because a
th
lot of, yeah.
I'm sorry, go
So,
ahead.
I'm saying a lot of us struggle with that thought quite a lot. And as a mother of a very young child, I myself sort of struggle to make that choice. Should I go technology way? Should I restrict and, you know, go the traditional way? So what would you suggest?
I think it's a mix. I think, you know, you mentioned that age is an issue. I think there's a point at which a parent needs to make a decision about when is it appropriate for a child to be able to start manipulating a tablet. When do you want to make sure that they're using their own creativity to play during the day? But I think it's just a decision that needs to be made. And of course, as the children are older, parents have the ability and responsibility to make sure. When I kind of caught myself when I was saying earlier that the whole universe is available to them. The whole universe should not be available to them. We should make sure that we control what digital media that they're engaged with or excited about. But I don't think we can go back. I think we have to, and it's so early on, I think many parents across the world are trying to figure out just where do we draw the line? And where do we make sure that the kids don't get over-organized around their tools, but at the same time, let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater, because they're just, especially for our dyslexic kids, there's just far too many tools that are going to keep them engaged and excited about the learning process. And we want to make sure that that doesn't get shut down. So I think it's got to be a mixture of both. And it's, I don't think, you know, again, it's like another webinar topic. You know, we talk about the top 10 things we should think about or questions we should think about when we make those decisions for our kids based on their age.
Yeah. I still think that it's a very difficult choice to make. But moving on to the next question. So the next question is, what are the early signs to look for in a child for any form of learning differences?
Okay, let me answer that this way. When you look at the statistics, 80% of the kids who are identified as having learning issues are going to have issues with language processing. Mm-hmm. So one of the things you look for in the area of dyslexia is you look at the very early ages in the preschool period, you look at things like, are they struggling with the idea of rhyming? Are they struggling with the idea of alliteration? You know, cat, bat, hat, things like that. How is their language developing in generally in terms of their expressive language and their receptive language? With the caveat that there's a great deal of developmental variation in terms of how children develop their language skills. Now, you know, again, especially in India, many of you are multilingual, right? You're exposed to lots of different languages, so we have to be really careful. But I think, you know, as I mentioned earlier, with regard to any concern about language development, it's important to monitor super closely. Do not buy into the idea of just let it wait, let them, you know, just be sure. I would much rather a parent or a teacher move in and try to intervene if they see anything, as opposed to saying, let's wait another year and see how they develop, because that's where we get in a lot of trouble, where kids fall behind. So rhyming for preschoolers, rhyming, alliteration, rapid automatic naming, as I mentioned, for you know, colors and objects. As they get into the early school years, how well are they able to start with the letter identification process, the sound simple process, you know, all those really early stage reading skills that really serve as the foundation, quite frankly, right? So,
So you spoke about multiple languages, and in a country like India, where, you know, usually we grow up learning 2 to 3 languages, one of our listeners wants to ask, like, how should rapid naming tasks be conducted for children who learn 2 languages?
Well, and I'm basically quoting our colleague, Dr. Nandini Singh, who's developed the DALI method of screening. And her I think her recommendation, which I think is absolutely spot on, is that we need to determine what the mother language is for the child.
Mm-hmm.
So if there is one particular language that would be considered their dominant mother language, mother tongue, then that would be the language we would use. And certainly for rapid automatic naming, there's absolutely no problem with regard to being able to create screenings or tests using the basic language of that particular community. There's absolutely no reason why we can't do that. And so what it reflects then is on a global level, we've become really clear that dyslexia and the issue with language processing, phonological processing, is global. It's quite consistent. It's not socioeconomic based. It's not ethnicity based. It's not culturally based. It's a part of a neurobiological profile that you see everywhere in the world. So I think if a child's learning two different languages when they're first starting, is there a way, is there a way to say, well, I think, you know, their true mother tongue is Hindi versus Canada. Is that the right way to say it?
Yeah, Canada, yeah.
So it's... if Nandini was here, I would say, Nandini, could you please expound on that? But she's one of the top neuroscientists in the country. She can tell you in depth.
She is definitely listening.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So, Nandini, would you like to contribute? I'm trying to... Nandini? Okay, I think I'm not able to connect her, but so there's another question that has just popped in, is do environmental or lifestyle factors affect the number of cases with learning differences?
What was the first part of that question?
Do environmental or lifestyle factors affect the number of cases with learning differences?
Yes, so we have to be careful here because there are neurobiological bases for a lot of kids, and then there are also environmental issues with a lot of children who maybe are from more impoverished homes where there isn't quite as much emphasis on the development of pre-reading skills, or there isn't as much emphasis on things like vocabulary development. And so over time, if that issue isn't addressed, and they're not given opportunity to develop those basic skills and develop their vocabulary understanding and, again, the oral language piece, then they could certainly present as someone with a learning difference. However, with proper instruction, you're likely to see a more rapid recovery to an age-appropriate level. But with neurobiology, that's a very different and specific issue that's, by and large, people believe now that it's genetic, runs in families.
Okay. So in terms of, you know, lifestyle changes, what are the things that parents or teachers can do to, you know, to teach multiple languages to children? So basically, what I wanted to ask is, like, what is a better strategy for teaching multiple languages to children, sequential or simultaneous?
Boy, I'm to be perfectly honest, I'd rather have Nandini answer that because I don't want to get into areas where that's not my expertise. Unfortunately, many of us in the United States, we learn one language, and it's unfortunate, and it's really kind of a weakness of ours, but I think, you know, and this is again just my opinion, it's not based on expertise, and that is that it happens organically simultaneously. So I don't think we really would, in a home environment, we really want to think about it in terms of it being, you know, sequential, because that's just not reality, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think there are family cultural issues, there are family issues, there's environmental issues that would drive that more so than any kind of a rational decision. That's literally my personal opinion. I'm not an expert, so I don't want to represent myself inappropriately, but that's my thinking off the top of my head. But I can say this is that in terms of literacy development, one thing that parents can do is just read with your child every day.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in terms of the teachers, I think that's a multi-level issue. I think on a leadership level, at the national level, we need leaders that are going to understand and support efforts to create legislation to make sure that our teachers are properly supported in their university programs in terms of the importance of oral language and literacy development. And I think that has to be reflected in the professional development as well. And I think that's one of the things that we at UNESCO and GIEP are trying to influence.
Yeah.
So that's a big job, but it's, in the United States, I will say really quickly, I know we probably have to wrap up, but in the United States, we have a real crisis because only 25% of our teachers in university programs learn anything about how a child learns how to read, which to me is stunning and shocking, and it has to change because, that's how we learn. From the first couple of years, we learn to read, and after that, we read to learn. So I think it requires a huge national cultural shift in order for us to support our teachers properly.
Yeah. So, Dr. Hart, one of the questions that I have is that boys learn to talk later than girls. So do you think it's a myth or it's a reality?
Well, again, there's a great deal of developmental variation with regard to how kids learn how to speak. I don't know what the most current research is. Again, I don't want to get out of my range of expertise, but I do know, if I remember correctly from my research from long ago, that girls do tend to develop a little bit more quickly.
Okay.
Beyond that, I think that's an issue of instruction. I don't think it does us any favors to. And again, I think I might be getting too far out of my realm of experience or expertise. But I think there's just a lot of developmental variation, and we should make sure that we treat kids the same way, whether they're boy or girl.
Okay. So maybe this can be the last question for the day that I have just received. The question is, here the RAND focuses on cognitive skills.
Mm-hmm.
So some children may read faster and are perceived higher on speed of object. So how can we tackle this?
I'm not quite sure I understand the question.
Yeah, even I'm not too sure. So I'll take another question from one of our participants. The question is, do sports or digital games help in better concentration and engagement in reading?
There's a very interesting dynamic happening in the United States right now where we are increasing the amount of break time and fun, play recess time is what they call it in the United States. And we're seeing cognitive improvements or academic improvements in performance if children are given more time to play during the day. So I am a proponent of that. I think that there's a tendency, and this is again my personal opinion, that there's a tendency to want to really overdo the academic pieces, particularly with really young kids, without giving them the opportunity to really just purely play. So I'm really interested to watch the research here in the States and elsewhere where it's clear we give the kids more time to play and it actually improves their academic performance. The same with homework is a really big issue here, where there's a tendency in the United States to really load the kids up with massive amounts of homework, and the research is not necessarily supporting that large chunks of homework are really going to improve their learning over time and their academic performance. So it's, again, a balance, right? It's a balance of making sure that kids are happy and healthy, and I think with that, they're more available to learn.
What you said is very correct, that it's all about a balance, but I think many teachers and parents across the globe sort of struggle with that balance. Because I think the digital tools are also far more engaging than the traditional ways of teaching and learning, but one has to be very careful on where to draw a line and where to draw that balance.
The emphasis of what you said was it's a tool, and so therefore it's the bright and shiny new tool. So we can't get over organized around what it can do without thinking about how we're going to control how we use those tools to support our kids, right?
Yes. So thanks a lot, Dr. Hart, for a very enlightening talk and a very, very interesting interaction. I'm sure all our listeners have benefited a lot from the talk, and we look forward to hosting many more webinars with you. Thanks a lot for your time today.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. To all our listeners, the webinar will be available on UNESCO MGIP's website along with the presentation. You can download the presentation from our website. And thanks a lot, all of you, for registering today and being with us and being such great listeners and for all the questions that you have asked. Thanks a lot. We hope to see you in our future webinars. Thank you.